Hi, I'm Robin Hardin. It's time for Dreamcatcher. On today's episode, Bob shares a dream that he had several years ago. And even with the passing of time, sharing this dream stirs up some real strong emotions. And then my first guest, Elaine, she has dreams that help her to face fears that she has in real life. But this first dream she shares has some symbols I've never seen before in a dream. Watch and see what I'm talking about. My guest today on Dreamcatcher is Elaine Mount. Elaine's been here before. It's been a while, so I'm looking forward to catching up with her. Elaine, it's been a while since you've been on.
I have. This is a real privilege to me today, too. It's a lot of fun. It's good to see you again, too.
And I know the Lord's talking to you in dreams still, not again, but probably still.
That's good. I have two dreams that I wanted to share today.
Good.
But one of the first dream that I want to talk about was is a dream that I woke up, and it was just like so many dreams that was disturbing. I don't know if I was still working in the school system, because I used to work in the schools. Mm-hmm. But all I remember is there was a school, and it was a small school, kind of like a school like I used to go to, maybe just a smaller school. Wasn't a brick building or anything, so, and it may not have any significance, but I just remember the dream. And outside the school was, in the school yard is a big tree, like a big oak tree. And there was a lot of people gathering. It was like they had called a meeting. The schools, whoever was over the schools, had called a meeting. I know several people, maybe 50, gradually coming to this meeting, standing around under this tree. And it's like I'm there, but nobody really sees me. Mm-hmm. You know, my story of our life sometimes.
Yeah.
We're there, but nobody knows it.
Right.
but this was different. I was there, and I started hearing thunder, and I even felt the wind blowing. And so, because they're under a tree having a meeting, mm-hmm. it was like nobody under that tree realized or heard that it was thundering. Mm-hmm. And I hollered, it's getting ready to storm. It's getting ready to storm.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it's like one of those deals where nobody heard me even say that, even though I wasn't that far away.
Right.
But then I realized I'm standing over here, just watching. Mm-hmm. It's like I'm watching, but it's like where nobody knows you see it. They don't know you're there, but you're seeing this.
Right.
So I get louder, and I said, there's a storm coming. My thing was run for cover to a place of safety, because it's gonna storm, y'all are all under a tree. But they went over their meeting as if nobody felt the wind, mm-hmm. and nobody, as if it wasn't even storming under the tree.
Right.
And then I noticed over here in the school building, and I couldn't see the whole building. I could just see a part of it.
Mm-hmm.
But it was an old building that had these tall windows. And all of a sudden, it was like the storm was in that building.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, how did that, you know, like a tornado or something where the mm-hmm. the pressure builds up inside.
Right.
Well, the first thing I saw was there's a window here and there's one away from me. The one away from me, it was a man. And it was almost like he's floating sideways.
Mm.
And he's got on tan, not dark brown or light brown. It was just really pale tan. He just floated out the window, and I thought, and it scared me. And I thought, that the wind is blowing these people outside.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But he was just almost like a dead person. He was just like floating, like very calm.
Mm-hmm.
And that was disturbing to me. And then I noticed in this window, closest to me, was a little girl. She had on white, and she was doing the same thing, just floating right out. I don't know where they went. It was, I just remember them coming out really soft. And it wasn't long after she got out that a little boy, a student, mm-hmm. I'm assuming, and he was in white. And he was sideways going out, coming out that window. It wasn't mm-hmm. like glass breaking or anything, just slowly going out.
Wow.
And I remember saying to this crowd, who didn't hear me anyway, mm-hmm. but still, did y'all see that?
Right.
And then I woke up. What was that about? You know, what was that about?
That's really an unusual dream. I interpret so many dreams so many times. It's the same dream, with a little bit of difference for different people. But I've never had a dream like that. It's very different. The oak tree represents someone of authority, because in the Bible, the mighty oak. So I'm going to make you like a mighty oak. You know, it's a powerful person. We know this is about knowledge because of the school. But because the dream is from the Lord, it's about the knowledge of the Lord and the teaching of the Lord, and what are we teaching our children, and what are we teaching? And it's an old building, so we're teaching, this is old traditional stuff. But the storm is inside the church, which means God's trying to stir this, some of these teachings up. And because what's happening is our older people, even, and our younger people are or dead in Christ, you know, they're in this learning, they're dead. People might be, people perish because of lack of knowledge. And they're in the school, but they're not getting the knowledge that they need. Tan, beige, gray is a color of transition.
Really?
God wants to transition these people. There's still hope. The little children are in white because they're still innocent. They're still free of sin. And yet they're not getting the teaching they need to help them to be alive when they didn't walk out that window. They're like dead in as far as knowledge goes. And no one sees. These are the people of the world that don't even see. They're so busy having their meetings, planning their programs, planning their dinners, and looking at a man, a person, someone of authority. This could be church related, but it's such a corporate dream. It could be our country looking at the man. Yeah. It could be a church looking at the pastor. It's so generic to touch so many people that while we're focused on a person or someone of authority, we're not even seeing what's happening over here. They didn't feel the wind is the Holy Spirit. And even if it's a storm, it's, you know, the Lord wants to come in and clean. He wants to clean that school out. He wants to clean up and shake people up. And they don't even feel it. And you're that voice in the wilderness, you know. You're that voice going, do you not see this? Do you not hear this? Don't you feel the wind?
They're not heeding the warning.
They're not heeding the warnings when they're so real to you. I mean, you felt it.
Yeah.
You felt it emotionally. You felt the wind. And you think about in real life with all the signs spiritually that we see, and people don't see it. People don't feel that. I interviewed someone yesterday, and we were talking about angels. And I personally have never seen an angel. I know that they're here. I just haven't had the opportunity to see one. But I want to be aware. I want to be aware of what's going on. Yes. And so many people just aren't aware because they're focused on a person of authority or someone of power, and whoever that is, that they're not looking beyond themselves and the planning.
And that was, that's my greatest fear anyway. And when I say fear, it's such a concern that as a Christian, sometimes we Christians, we do hesitate to say what we feel God is showing us for fear that somebody's going to say, oh, you know, there's some kind of fanatical person, or there's some kind of holy roller, or a lot of times I think some people, deep down, I think they know what we're saying.
Oh, yeah.
But it's disturbing, and they don't really want to deal with it, so they kind of ignore you.
It's easier not to.
So sometimes Christians fail. Now, I was speaking with a lady last night. Sometimes I think Christians are so afraid to be criticized, even.
Yes.
But if we don't stand
and
see what God is showing us, because we have to go back in Scripture and remember that Jesus said, you are. He didn't say maybe. He said, you are going to be persecuted. If they persecuted me, you know they're going to persecute
we
you.
We can't get away from it.
We're not going to get away from it.
For you, the message, I mean, that was the message of that dream, but for you as the one he gave it to,
yes,
that is your confirmation that you do hear from the Lord, that you do feel His Holy Spirit as the wind,
yes.
That you do know that there's storms within the church that He's trying to clean up false teaching,
yes.
Dead teaching, and lack of knowledge, and that you are right, and that the masses, the crowd is over here, and you are back here going, can't you see that? Can't you feel that? Did you see this? You know,
yes.
They're not seeing this. And it's so real to you,
oh,
because
yes.
It is real. Mm-hmm. But that's God confirming to you. When you're asleep, when you have nothing to do about it, confirming to you, you did feel my wind.
Yeah.
You did see that I'm trying to stir up, and it's teaching, and it's false teaching. And you are not one of the crowd. You are standing back and watching it.
Mm-hmm.
And you are calling out. And even though they're not listening, you're still doing what you're supposed to do.
Yes, because when you know something's from God, whether it's a dream.
Yes.
Or whether you're just spending time studying.
Mm-hmm.
The Holy Spirit in us, our flesh is not good. Look, listen, I know a lot more of me than anybody else does. But the Holy Spirit in me is real.
Yes.
And when I'm studying His Word, where you know God's involved is when you're not just saying, I want to be right, people listen to me. Mm-hmm. You have such a heart for those people that you know are going the wrong path.
Yes.
Because we got to stand before God and give account. But just maybe the world, they're hungry for somebody just to be different from me.
Yes.
Be different from me.
Yes.
So this vehicle comes just barreling up the hill, just driving crazy out of control. And I sensed there was something wrong right away. Just the erratic behavior in which they was driving this vehicle, I knew something was really up. And it crashes right out in the front of the yard where I'm working. The vehicle comes run off the road and flipped over on its side and crashed. And I'm down on my knees working with the plumbing right at the entrance of that crawl hole. And I'm looking up to see what's going on, and these two men get out of that vehicle. And they came, walked straight over to where I was, and the guy pulled out a gun, and he leaned over, and he shot me right in the back of the head, just point blank range, just bone, just blew me right in the back of the head. And I remember intense pain from being shot. And he's looking at me, you know, see if I'm dead. And I'm laying there, I'm still alive, but I sure don't want him to know it because he's about to shoot me again. And this little pup dog, little pup dog comes along and bites me right in and just chewing. And this guy's watching. He's just standing with that gun. He's watching real closely to see if I flinch because he's going to shoot me again if I do. He's making sure I'm dead. And I remember Crawley is hurt, and I'm thinking, if that dog does a good job, on me, hurt it. And that was years ago. It was just night after night, I kept having basically the same message, dreams, that warnings that I've been targeted and marked. Targeted and marked, and he was set his sights out to kill me and destroy me.
Bob, thanks for this dream selfie. You know, I see you smile, and I hear the chuckling and the laughter in the background, but I feel the pain. This was a disturbing dream. It was a hard dream for you to share, and you're absolutely right. The devil has an agenda. He has a weapon formed and pointed at your head, and then he sends the little pup, the little foxes of what spoil the vine. That's what the Word of God says, and he's watching. He's just waiting for you to flinch so he can pull that trigger. That's a message to every one of us. The enemy has a weapon formed and pointed at us, at our soul, at our mind, at our emotions, at our thoughts. And then he sends the little pup, the little foxes, as the Word says, to spoil the vine. And he's waiting for a flinch. but in Christ. He will fight our battles, drop to our knees, open the word, and ask the Lord to remove that dog from biting and to remove that gun. The word says that no weapon formed against us will prosper. We can rely on the Lord. He will get us through this. Thank you, Bob, for sharing that heartfelt dream. Hey there, I have something very exciting I want to share with you. The new Dream Catcher Journal. It's geared to help you catch your dreams with over 50 scriptures, inspirational words, and revelations, all pointing to dreams and dream interpretation. In the back, there's a quick reference to help you with colors. Maybe you keep waking up at the same time or you have a favorite number that follows you. 44 different time scriptures, I call them, to help you find out what it is the Lord is saying to you. Straight from the Bible, symbols that you can compare your dreams with and find the scripture that might help you interpret your dream. In addition, there's 195 different symbols from past dream interpretations that will help you to catch your dream. Order yours today.
We're back with my guest, Elaine Mount. I hope you're enjoying visiting with her. She always has such profound messages from the Lord. And I know sometimes she knows part of the message, and sometimes you need a little bit of the details.
But well, the next one it's pretty to the point, and I don't have a lot of detail in it. I'll give you what detail I have, okay. And then get to the point. I heard about a church service. Somebody, I think, even invited me to a particular church. I don't know where. I don't even know who was there. I don't have any details on that. Okay. All I know is it was going to be the last night, and I decided, well, I'll go. So when I got there, I'm just zooming in. I'm not late, but I mean, I'm like, I can get there early and get the parking space like everybody else gets those good ones. So I'm parking. And I don't even know where this was at, but it was out some. But the where I had to end up parking was just lots of cars. And when I drove up, I thought, wow, this must be a good meeting going on in there. So I parked where nobody would park. It was the only thing left. But I do remember where I parked, because I'm nervous around water. Mm-hmm. And also, an embankment, so that represents heights to me, so that scared me, but that was the only place I had left to park. So I was facing the creek, or a small river. I think it was just a good flowing creek. And then, you know, there's an embankment, but I stopped there, but there's brush, trees and brush, but I could still see the water in between there. And so then I hurried and got to in the church. What went on in there, I do not know, because that's not a part of my dream. I remember going in there. Mm-hmm. I remember coming out.
It was about the parking.
It was. And that's why I started not even tell you anything about it, because I thought, well, I don't know, it's just something silly. But I do remember when I came out to go to my car, I saw three men down around by my car, but not men who had been there, young men, like maybe, in my mind I thought, oh, somebody's trying to break into my car. Mm-hmm. So that's all I know. And I started down that way, and one glanced up at me, and by the time he did, I go back in, because people are really pulling out of this parking lot, and I didn't want to be left alone, and I didn't want to go to my car alone.
Right.
So I go back in to see if there's someone still there to walk, to at least be out there while I walk my car.
Right.
And I did find somebody, whether it was a man or a woman, I don't know, I just know somebody came out. And about the time, and I said, well, somebody's out there around my car, so I don't go in my car alone. And all of a sudden, as I started walking toward my car, the men just disappeared. In my dream, I thought, I caught them. Mm-hmm. So they probably jumped, they're either in that brush or they got in that water, I don't know. So I never saw them anymore. But as we took, I bet we didn't take three steps toward my car to go down there, because it's a little ways down there. Mm-hmm. My car blew up. I mean, it just blew up. And right then I thought, oh, who were those men? They planted a bomb in my car. Why, you know? And I woke up. So that dream, when I woke up, of course, I was just petrified.
Wow.
And I was so grateful. You know how you do when I woke up? I thought, I'm so grateful. That was just a dream. But yeah, it was so real and vivid. And that's all I have on that dream. So.
Well, there's a lot of symbols in there. You were invited to come to a church service. So you were called into the presence of God, into a church service. And you went through a lot to get to it, and you faced fears. Mm-hmm. You faced your fear of height to get to it. You faced your fear of water to get to it.
Yeah.
You did it, and it's interesting that it was the last day of the service, because it's never too late. And that was, as soon as you said it was like in my spirit, it's like it's never too late.
Yeah.
So whatever the Lord is calling us to, it doesn't matter that we missed it the first how many years. It's never too late for you to step in, and that's what that was. And your life, you've faced some fears in life, mm-hmm. to get into His presence. Mm-hmm. And that's why you can't determine where this church is or who it was, because it's the presence of God in this dream that the church is showing. And when you're in there, with all the journey, I mean, it's been a journey. You finally get there, you're safe, you don't even remember because it's safe, you're protected. And then as soon as you step out into the world again, there's danger. You knew if you went back into the church to get someone to walk with you, there's help there. So whatever is going through in life, sometimes it's so easy to just get out of church. I'm too tired today, or I'm too whatever. Mm-hmm. As soon as we step out, we have stepped out from underneath His protection.
Right,
and He's just letting you know your help is in His presence, and it's real people who are going to help you. Mm-hmm. So whatever the enemy throws at you, you don't get out of His presence. And it's okay to reach out for people. It's okay to go back in and go, can you help walk me to the car? It could be a male, it could be a female. It's, God uses people to help each other.
Yes.
And then as you're walking with someone to your car, you think at first the danger is gone, and they've planted a bomb. So had you just decided, oh, it's okay, I'm just gonna go to my car, the results would have been disastrous.
Yes.
But because you used discernment, you used wisdom, you realized that there was something going on, and you went back into His presence, and you got one of His children to walk with you.
Yes.
The plan of the enemy, part of it still happened. The car blew up, but you weren't harmed.
That's
so we can't change people's free will. These men had a free will to blow your car up. God didn't change their free will, but because you listened to that voice of discernment and went back in and got help, someone to walk with you, the plan to harm you didn't manifest. So it's just so easy to think, I'm embarrassed to ask for help. Or like if you miss a Sunday and then you miss another Sunday, then it's the third Sunday. It's just so hard to get back because what are people going to think? It's sort of like an altar call. And as a board member, I know I should go up front. And it's like, what will people think I'm up here for? It doesn't matter what people think I'm up there for.
Right.
I could be up there for me. I could be up there for someone else. It doesn't matter. And that's what He's saying to you. You went back in and you got that help. You could have gone, oh, I can do, I'm okay, but there's using wisdom.
It's amazing, though, even more so. Well, you know a little bit about my life, but the past 43 years when I gave my life to Christ, it's not been an easy journey. It cost me something. Now, when I say cost me something, I use that real lightly because Christ already paid it.
Yes.
It never cost me
money. Sure.
So when I look back, I'm grateful that it didn't come easy for me, because that could have gone either way.
Right.
But because I knew the Holy Spirit was in me, and there's been a lot of battles. But and just you saying that, I've always been afraid to ask help. Mm-hmm. I like to help, mm-hmm. but you know how so many of us, it's we need to learn how to receive, because it's real hard.
We're givers.
We're givers.
Find it hard to receive.
But we don't. Yes. But a lot of people, and it's something I felt God had shown me through His Word. And I even wrote this in a book, you know, I had written in. But the thing that I found that was so interesting in that was learning to receive.
Yeah.
Because there's something in us that if somebody pays you a compliment, you try to tell them every reason they should not have.
Yes.
You know,
yes.
This old dread, or we, you know, or you know, instead of just saying thank you,
whatever.
But where that is a danger to not know how to receive. Mm-hmm. Is a lot of people will not receive Christ because it's nothing you can do.
Yes.
You can't give Him, you know.
Yes, that's good.
So I don't want to take over your show, but I'm just saying, I'm so passionate about it because we cannot give Him anything so we'll deserve Him giving back to us.
Right.
The only way we can, we have to receive from Him.
Yes.
He's wanting to give us something. The only way we can have it is to receive. And another thing, if we don't learn how to receive, that is what breaks His heart. Because He's saying, I've already paid this for you. And you're telling me, if I bought a gift, and I spent so much time making it perfect for you, Robin, and I hand it to you, and you say, I don't want it. And I, in my mind, I'm thinking, oh, if you only knew what I went through to get this for you. That is the picture that the Lord allowed me one time, for me, it was for me.
Right.
And then I can share it with to say, Lane, you need to learn how to receive. You want to help everybody, that's great.
Yeah.
But you need to learn how to receive. Sometimes you need to let people minister to you.
Yeah.
That was always hard for me, but when you were saying that and going back in, I can just relate so much because it's so hard. I didn't go just traipsing down there anyway, afraid.
Right.
But I did have to overcome a lot of fear.
But that was such a corporate meeting too for us, for all of us to not just be in His presence, because some people are in His presence but aren't in a congregation. And we need people. Yes. We need people. That's why He says not to avoid the assembling of yourselves.
Right.
Because we need someone to walk with us to our car. We need someone to just say, oh, man, I've had a bad day. Or I've had a fabulous day. What if you've had this wonderful testimony and there's no one who gets it that you can share it
with?
Thank you. It's so good to have you.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. Don't go away. We'll be back.
Next time on Dreamcatcher, my guest is the director of the Clarksville Healing Rooms. The Lord is talking to him through dreams about wrecking the car of a pastor and also about moving a mobile home. And then Shonda sends in a dream selfie that is about some dark family secrets. And I gave her the very difficult interpretation, but I got feedback later that this helped to bring freedom to her family.